You might have heard NPR's series last week on a new drug being used to treat depression. It's called ketamine and can almost instantly relieve symptoms of depression. The effectiveness of the experimental treatment also suggests that long-held beliefs about what causes depression may no longer be true. Joining me is Dr. Sid Zisook, professor of psychiatry at UC San Diego Medical Center and the San Diego VA. Doctor, thank you for being here.
Thank you.
So what has been the traditional theory of what causes depression?
Well, there's no one traditional theory, but a lot of people have talked, at least in the biological reign, that low levels of neurotransmitters, particularly serotonin, but also dopamine and norepinephrine, are the causes of depression.
And so how do we treat that? If this is the cause, how have we been treating it for the past couple of decades?
Well, the treatment with antidepressant medications has been using medications that actually improve the balance of those neurotransmitters. The most popular medications right now are the so-called serotonin reuptake inhibitors that essentially increase levels of serotonin in the brain.
So like Prozac?
Prozac would be one. And some of the other medications increase not only serotonin, but also either norepinephrine or dopamine. And so that's been the kind of the traditional way of approaching depression medically. I would say that in recent years we've learned a lot more about psychotherapies as well, and there are some very, very effective psychotherapies for the treatment of depression as well. And those may also alter the balance of those neurotransmitters, but not as directly as medications seem to do.
So what new theories are emerging in terms of chemically what's happening in our brain?
Well, we know it's not as simple as just increasing neurotransmitters. The neurotransmitters may increase within minutes to hours after taking an antidepressant, and yet someone's depression may not respond for 2, 3, 4 or more weeks afterwards. So we've looked more into what's happening in the nerve cells themselves, the neurotransmission, other chemicals that affect a neurotransmission. We've looked at genetic causes. And I think the leading theories now are that it's multifactorial, that there are biological factors, psychological factors, social factors, and there's an interaction between the two, and some very interesting studies that have looked at an interaction between genetics and stress, and people that have a genetic vulnerability are much more likely to get depressed under the same stressors as somebody without that genetic vulnerability, but the genetic vulnerability itself doesn't lead to depression without the stress.
So if you know that, how does treatment change?
Doesn't change much, but it does open the door for more experimentation, and there are lots of newer treatments and newer psychotherapies and newer medications, and in fact, you know, some of the exciting new medications don't affect those neurotransmitters, at least not directly, and may affect other targets in the brain in order to be effective for depression.
I want to talk a little bit about ketamine now. Some people know this even as really a drug and that people are using on the street, you know, sort of to get high. But also, this is being used now on an experimental basis that apparently you inject it, and within hours, this fog of depression lifts. What do you know about ketamine?
Right. Well, it's a very interesting drug. It's been around for a while. It started out as an anesthetic in animals, and veterinarians thought it was a wonderful drug. And it's used as an anesthetic in humans in some cases now. And it has been found to profoundly affect depression and very quickly. It's an IV formulation. Somebody who can be severely depressed may be a different person within minutes. Unfortunately, it doesn't last, and you know, even if the depression is totally eradicated, it may be for days to a week at most. And it is a drug of potential abuse. It's like PCP. People hallucinate with too much of it, and so it's not an ideal drug for depression. But it's really providing great hope that we might be able to find medications like that that can be given orally. That may have much faster actions than the present antidepressants and potentially be much more effective.
We don't have a lot of time, but quickly before we go, we know that here in San Diego they're experimenting with this drug, aren't they?
Right. There's at least two studies I'm aware of, one at UCSD. Dr. David Feifel has a study where he's using ketamine for people who have not responded to traditional psychotherapies and pharmacologic treatments for depression. And there's also a study in the San Diego Hospice where people who are there who are dying don't have weeks to wait if they're depressed. And ketamine can be an incredible treatment if effective and tolerated. And so those are two places where very interesting studies are being done.
Dr. Sid Zisook, thank you so much for being here.
Thank you.